So the for loop is an alternative to the while loop, and it's optimal for counting or iterating over a given set of elements. For example, you can iterate over a number of instructions a number of times, like summing up the numbers in an array. So its structure looks as follows. We have the keyword for, and then we have an initializer part, a condition, and an iteration part. And then we have finally our statements, those that we are looping over. So what are these three different sections now for? Firstly, when we enter a for loop, this initializer code has always been executed once. Then we have our condition, which is checked. And we have lastly a set of statements, which can are the iterations that move basically a counter or some elements further on. Okay, so there are also some kind of operations inside the iteration. So these three sections are separated by the semicolon. And here is the flowchart, how it looks like. So we initialize with some statements. You can actually have more than one statements, and they need to be separated with a normal comma in this case. Then you evaluate the condition, and if the condition is true, then you run the statements, which is our loop body. And after the statements have been run, you run all these statements inside the iteration. So you may wonder, why would you need these kind of statements inside iteration if I can put them inside the loop body directly as statements? And you will see it helps in terms of structuring code because the code becomes a bit more readable. So here we see an example. We have a counter, which is a control variable. And now we have our for loop, and we initialize the counter with 1. We say the counter should be iterated until it is, bigger than 10. And then we have our increment section, where we say the counter should be incremented by 1. So just by looking at the header, we understand how this for loop works. So we start from 1, the loop iterates as long as the counter is smaller than 10, and every time we increment the counter by 1. So how often is this code executed? Well, 10 times. And what code do we do? Well, we print the number of our iteration. So we print the numbers in this case from 1 to 10. Here we have now our flowchart for this specific example. We start counter as 1 as a control variable. Then we evaluate the condition. Is the counter less than 10? If that's true, then we print the counter, and then we execute counter plus plus, and we run the condition again. So a very simple flow here. So next, let's talk about how we can control the loops a bit further. And there's a break command, which allows us to exit from a loop. So like a while loop, a for loop, a do while loop, whatever loop, when once you encounter the break command, you exit immediately the loop body and terminate the loop. Similar to our switch statement, where we also terminated the flow of the switches throughout the cases. So, and once it encounters a break command, well, we execute the first statement after our loop. So it's typically used inside the loops to escape early from a loop. When you encounter an error, for example, you may want to quit whatever you were doing, or to skip, in this case for the switch, you want to skip the remainder of our switch statements. So here's an example. We have again our for loop. We start with a counter of 0. As long as the counter is smaller than 10, we run this code, and then we increment the counter. But something bad happened here, which we check in our if condition here. Then we break the execution of the for loop and can stop earlier. So now let's create a couple of examples to put this into perspective. Let me save this as 4.c. So let's recreate, first of all, let's recreate the same behavior that we had here with our for loop. We printed the number 1 up to 3. So with the for loop, what we can do, we can put everything into the initializer. We can say the counter is 1, and we can declare also counter to be of a type integer. And then we have to put a condition. Well, the condition was as long as the counter is less than 3. What we want to do is we want to increment the counter by 1. So from the while loop, we have in this case removed the last statement, which was counter plus plus, and moved it into our iteration statement of the for loop. So that's basically our code for the while loop, and I think you would agree that it's rather easy to understand that we have our counter here and it counts from 1 to 3 just by looking at a header. Let me compile it, gcc4, and run it. It counts from 1 to 3. Now, let's assume every time we perform an operation, we may get a return value that is not necessarily indicating success. So there might be an error happening. So let's say in this case, if counter is 2, what we want to do, we want to break. Okay? So this code will work, and it will stop the loop prematurely at iteration 2. So again, you can play through what's going to happen, what is executed. We execute the initializer, then we run the condition. The condition is met. We print counter. Counter in this case is 1, so we don't trigger the body of our selection and condition here. So then we go on, we increment counter by 1. Next, we do run the check. Is counter less than 3? Yes, it's 2, so it's still true. So we continue with the loop body, we print counter, which is 2. Now the counter is 2, so we break, and that means immediately we jump to the end of the loop. Let me print something here, end of the iteration, such that you can see that we will really stop at the break. So as you can see, we print number 1, then we reach the end of the iteration, then we print number 2, but then we break the loop without doing anything else and print the next statement after the loop. Okay, so like I said, this is now, normally we would do it with an error message, so we would have something like int error at 0, for example, and assume if there is an error, then we would break the loop. Right, so that's kind of how you could do it, and somehow we have a way, of course, to modify what an error means here, right? But I don't go into this yet. I'll do this on another time. Now we see that the loop is again printed 3 times, because the error is, of course, all the time 0. There's also another interesting operation that you can perform, which is continue. So with the continue statement, you skip the remaining statements in the body of a loop and just proceed with the next iteration of the loop. So that works for the while and do while loop and as well for the for loop. And let me show you. If counter equals 2, then what we want to do is we want to continue. Okay, so why is that interesting? Well, in this case, when the number is 2, we don't want to execute any code underneath anymore, so we just continue with the iteration of our main loop, and let's see what it prints. So it prints 1, end of iteration. If the iteration is 2, right, we get into the statements of the condition, we perform the continuation, and we don't print any further code, right? over here, and yeah, that's exactly what we see here. The message is omitted. Good. Here's another example. Well, here the case was that someone wants to read text from the user into a variable, and as long as the number that is that the value is converted to is invalid, we want to print the user that the value is invalid, and we continue, which means we skip the rest of the code. And if the code is if the text that has been read is valid, we would increase the number of lines that we read. Yeah. And in this case, we want to stop maybe, depending on the keyboard input, if it is a specific number, we want to stop the iteration. Like pressing the escape key, at this point, you may want to stop reading from user input.